Recorded Books and One Click Digital present Shadow of the Mountain, Exodus, by Cliff Graham. Narrated by Brian Hutchison and Richard Ferrone.
Part 1. From Exodus, chapter 15, verse 3. The Lord is a warrior. The Lord is his name. Chapter 1. Morning. The mornings were the hardest. Every bone ached, every old scar throbbed. His wrist no longer bent back fully, and on nights when he slept on his side without realizing it, he was unable to move that side without pain for most of the day. Caleb greeted this morning like any other, with a casual assessment of these pains. Nothing seemed to be abnormal. Some pains were injuries needing to be tended, others were just the advance of age. When it was cold, as now, he took longer getting dressed. The approach of spring led the young troops to switch to summer tunics, but he would be wearing the thick wool winter cloak all summer long. Even the desert heat was no longer enough to thaw his bones. "But I can still move," he thought, as he rubbed his feet. He squeezed his leg with his sword hand, the fingers pressing hard into flesh. He still had his battle grip. When that softened, he would be done, but it was nearly as strong as when he was in the fiery power of youth. Now he rolled onto his knees and paused, giving the joints time to loosen before he stood. He would be fine once he was up and his blood flowed through his veins. It was just the wake-up, he told himself. Just the wake-up. He exhaled slowly, then held his breath for the effort to stand. With a grunt, he forced his back to straighten and pushed off the ground. The muscles relaxed and he was up. As he stretched, he remembered the first time he'd been roused by a training master many years before. Shouting, kicking, he had three counts before he was supposed to be fully dressed with weapon in hand. Now it felt like it was three counts just to open his eyes. "Enough," he said aloud to himself in the dark. The wind battered the tent, and he heard the thumping sound of heavy raindrops. He scowled. It would be another day of delays. Delays meant lost advantage. Delays favored the enemy. He tried to be hopeful that it was only a passing storm and would give way to bright sunlight. But as soon as he looked out of his tent and blinked at the sky, he saw nothing but heavy darkness overhead. And as though mocking him, the rain clouds opened up and poured down onto the camp. Puddles formed in the mud nearby. Men who had ventured out into the open scurried to find shelter. A figure appeared in front of him. "Permission to enter, Lord?" "No," Caleb said. Silence outside. Caleb smiled to himself, decided to have mercy. "Speak quickly," he said. "We need your instructions, Lord."
"Send the others in so we can study the assault. They can spend the day teaching it to the men again and again until it is too firm in their minds to forget. Perhaps the weather will lift tomorrow."
The commander disappeared. Caleb made out other men running from tree to tree and overhang to overhang. The men would be grumbling about the weather, about the lack of information, about how each other smelled. They would complain about everything, including him. Whoever was commanding was complained about. He used to complain, too, when he was a simple foot soldier. Oh, how he missed it. He withdrew into his tent. He struck flint and lit a torch, then slid it into the mount on the center pole. He watched the smoke billow heavily at first, as the fresh oil caught before wafting out of the slits in the goatskin overhead. A scratching sound at the tent flap.
"Come in."
A stream of men entered the tent. They shook their cloaks off and shivered, stamping their feet and continuing conversations begun outside. Caleb waited for them to settle, and they all took their seats on rugs.
"Men," he said, trying not to sound tired. "We do not have reinforcements yet. Joshua cannot spare them. But the weather has provided us an opportunity to wait another day or so before attacking. Perhaps they will arrive by then."
He reached out with a short pointing stick, ornately carved by his own hand to resemble a spear, and drew the outline of a city in the dirt. The commanders huddled close to see it.
"Did everyone get a glimpse of the city before night fell?"
Nods and affirmations all around.
"You saw the main gate?"
"Yes, Lord,"
one of the younger ones said.
and the stones we can climb near it. Caleb nodded. Your mission? To get over the wall and open the gate using 3 men. These men have been selected?
Yes, Lord, my best.
Caleb was satisfied. He nodded to the young leader. Well done, Othniel. Make sure your men rehearse it.
Yes, Lord.
Caleb searched the faces, until he spotted a middle-aged man with missing teeth and a nose heavily distorted from multiple breaks. Adino, show me what you'll be doing. Adino took the pointing stick from him and traced a route beginning from the outside of the city.
My lead force will follow me through the water drainage to the city's sewer ditch. We will climb through the well shafts until we reach the streets, then attack west along the wall until we have cleared that quarter of soldiers. We meet up with you at the gate if something goes wrong.
Second mission?
Support the capture of the House of Anak in the north of the city, if it has not been taken yet.
Why?
The giants control the city. Anakites have been a nemesis to peace for generations.
Caleb reached over for the pointing stick and handed it to the other commanders one by one. They walked him through the plan he himself had created. It was complicated, more complicated than he was comfortable with. He believed the simpler a plan, the better. But this city and these people had proven to be worthy foes. The Hebrews would have to attack in unexpected ways. Even so, he had simplified it as much as possible. One primary and one secondary mission per unit, and therefore per soldier. A soldier could forget a lot of things and be forgiven so long as he knew his mission. Caleb knew his men were green. They'd been tested a bit in battles on the plains and in skirmishes in the foothills. But now they were in the mountains and staring at a fortified city filled with giants. He had no way of knowing how they would respond. They had been trained in how to fight this specific enemy, yet that meant nothing before the first combat. Would they learn? Would they adapt? Would they maintain their ferocity in the face of plans falling apart and suffering losses? When the last man had finished, Caleb sat staring at the map quietly. The others remained silent, knowing better than to speak when their general wasn't ready to listen. The wind picked up outside the tent. The rain grew heavier.
Adino, you are certain they do not know that we know about the waste ditch access into the city.
I killed the man we bribed myself. They do not know it. They will never believe that we would be willing to crawl through excrement to kill them. I cannot believe it myself, to be sure.
The others laughed. Caleb nodded. Every approach in Main Street had been sketched by their spies. But a map was never the battlefield. What buildings were left out? What archery positions? Would the citizens all fight themselves or leave that to the soldiers and surrender easily? Was there enough food inside to provide for his troops once they had it? Was every enemy escape route covered? He rubbed his forehead. Impossible to know. Trust those in your command to do their duty.
Go back to your men and let them rotate through the tents to get warm and dry throughout the day. Make sure the perimeter watch stays alert. I will be checking myself to ensure it. If the chiefs of the Anakites hear we are already encamped this close, and they believe our perimeter is weak, then nothing would stop them from sending a surprise attack to frighten us off, even in the storm.
He reclined on his rug, and this was the signal for them to leave. They all stood and began talking again. Caleb stretched his back out flat on the ground, listening to them. He was about to close his eyes when he saw that Othniel had remained behind. The young leader, 20 years old, was staring hard at the map and scratching his short beard in thought.
It is possible to be too prepared, Caleb said.
How do you know the difference between being too prepared and not prepared enough? Caleb thought about it a moment.
Not prepared is when you stay up all night terrified that you have no idea what you're doing. Too prepared is staying up all night terrified that you have no idea what you are doing.
Othniel smiled.
You tell that to all the young ones like me, don't you?
You are prepared.
I hope so. Do you believe the men are?
As prepared as we can make them. They should have enough motivation with their women and children nearby.
Was that your plan all along?
Where else would we put them,
Caleb asked. This is our inheritance. We have nowhere else to go. We live where we conquer.
Othniel gazed at the map a moment longer, then said, When did you see your first major battle? Caleb laid his head back and looked at the ceiling of the tent. The torch was dimming.
Could you replace that? He asked, gesturing to the torch.
Othniel picked up the candle lantern and hung it on the pole, using the dying torch to light it. It was a duller light than the torch, but it would last longer.
Egypt, many years ago, Caleb finally answered.
Why haven't you told your story to the men? They would benefit from hearing it.
What story?
The time you were in Egypt.
We know the account of Moses and Joshua. Our fathers composed songs and inscribed records. But we have never heard from you on it.
Why does it matter?
It is our history. It would be good for the men.
What did they say about me?
That you were formed out of the mud by Yahweh and have no mother.
Good, Caleb said.
That's what they need to know.
Uncle, we have time. There is nothing to do. This storm isn't going to calm down before nightfall. Tell me of the old days.
The weather could clear.
You know it will not. The rain fell harder, even as he listened to it. Blowing in from the great sea, these storms stayed trapped in the highlands and didn't move on until the western deserts sent their own dry winds to push it back. He knew he may have to resign himself to the truth, that it was one of those storms that lasts for days, possibly weeks. But he bitterly hated the idea and therefore preferred to deny it.
I do not like reliving the old days, Caleb said dismissively.
Many young men would learn from it. We would be able to grow in wisdom, unlike our father's generation. Caleb sighed. Othniel knew right where to press him.
They can read the scrolls of the scribes, Caleb said.
Those have few details.
They have all they need to know. They were written by the hand of Moses himself, many of them.
True, but there is always more to learn. When you go to your grave, you do not want us to squander what we may have learned from you, do you?
You are using my own words against me. Whatever it takes, Uncle.
Caleb was quiet. No part of him wished to say anything about Egypt. But his nephew was right. If there was a chance that even a single young man could learn from his experience and choose the path of Yahweh over idolatry.
You will check on your men later, he said, resigned.
I will, Othniel said. Impatient, he added. They said you were in the armies of Pharaoh, that you were a great hero for him.
I learned the warrior arts from the Egyptians, as did Moses, Caleb conceded.
Othniel leaned forward. Please, tell me of it.
Where do you want me to begin? Caleb asked, settling into the cushions that were his only yield to comfort in his old age.
How you got to Egypt, how you met Joshua, Yahweh parting the seas, everything. He sat forward, as though unable to believe he had actually convinced the old man to talk.
Caleb saw himself in Othniel's expression. Long ago, when there were not cities filled with giants to attack, or aching bones that hurt even worse during storms. I will tell you, on the promise that you will ensure the other young men will read of what the Lord God did.
I will tell them, I promise.
Othniel pulled out a set of charcoal writing sticks and some sheets of parchment.
Caleb eyed him.
You came prepared.
I expected to win you over eventually. Perhaps a bribe if it came to it.
Caleb smiled. He let his eyes relax behind their closed lids and grew very still, took several deep breaths.
The rain continued to pelt the tent, and he concentrated on the sound. The memories were deep and hidden. They would emerge only if Yahweh allowed them to, and only to accomplish his purposes.
Darkness, rain,
the musty, damp smell of the wet tent. His senses grew sharp. From deep within him, an image emerged. An image long lost, but one that grew bolder and clearer until he saw golden sand and piercing blue skies, and mountains made by man.
Chapter 2. To the Land of Gold. You will hear it said that I fight to live in peace. Nonsense. I fight so that our women and children can live in peace. You will always find me where there is battle. Battle is what we are here for. It is all we should know as men while we have breath. Give the enemy battle all of your life, and when you die, chase him into the afterlife and give him battle there. Perhaps then the Lord will give us peace. But don't expect it. I will go to my grave with honor. It will be written that my woman loved me, my children admired me, and the enemy feared me. And yet, I was not always a warrior. You must remember that it has been 50 or 60 years since much of this happened. My memory has faded. I will miss some details. But I remember a few things very vividly. The brotherhood I found as I trained in Pharaoh's armies. The rattle of chariot riggings as teams pulled hundreds of us in a broad hawk formation, striking the purest terror into the hearts of our enemies. Then there were the 10 times that Yahweh smote the Egyptians with his outstretched arm. A river of blood, swarms of lice, gnats, and flies. Darkness, always darkness, endless oppressive darkness. Death, the seas parting before us, the pillar of smoke and flame that led us by night, the taste of the manna and quail that we ate, the hot stench of blood and the metal of weapons glinting under the sun as we killed the Amalekites, the endless fire of the deserts, all of those things are as fresh to me as you sitting before me. In the beginning, I remember the day that I left my village. I carved stone and wood, and I was skilled. My hammer and chisel could draw out the form of any animal from the rock. My knife could bring life to any log. The other children would gather around me as I made small rocks turn into birds and whittled serpents out of branches. My father, Jafana, encouraged it as a hobby, believing it made my fingers strong and my mind sharp, but only when my chores were done, late at night. I was good enough to draw the attention of a man passing through my village on his way to Damascus who said they hired men like me in Egypt to create the palaces and idols of worship. I had heard talk like this before. Living on the frontier of the Negev in those days meant you had to be near the trade roads. But when I told my father what they said, he would have none of it. The Egyptians were our enemy. But I never forgot those words. My birth clan was the Kenaz. Our lands were in the hills between the Negev and here. We were not concerned with many things other than our goats and how to stay warm in winter. My father was an elder. He was a just man. He would let me sit on the branch of a sycamore above the meetings of the elders and listen as they passed judgment on the members of the tribe brought before them. He was always careful to let the accused defend themselves, and widows were always met with mercy. I've thought about him over the years. I wonder if his home as a child affected how he judged. As I remember him, my grandfather was a hard man who treated my father harshly. My father never said as much, but I think it was a relief when the old man lost his powers of speech. When my grandfather finally died, my father wept for hours. I do not think they were tears of grief. Thereafter, my father loved me and cherished me. I never felt alone. He brought me into the village meetings, even when it was protested by other men. He took me into the hills and taught me the flight of arrows and the sweat of a good day's work. We trained for hours with the dagger, for there were no swords to go around in those days. He knew I must be able to protect my home from bandits one day and ensured that I was prepared. When I was old enough, he released me. I think it grieved him that I wanted to go to Egypt, but he could no longer forbid it. "They are wicked people," he told me as we walked down the road outside of town. "I will return," I answered, "with enough gold to buy cattle for 100 years. Father only shook his head and said, "Egypt draws many, she devours many as well." I did not understand at the time, of course. I was young. To my thinking, Egypt was the land of exotic mystery and the only place that traveling merchants failed to adequately describe because its wonders were so vast. I knew I could carve well and draw with charcoal sticks, and I was strong. Those would get me by. We embraced once more. I felt his hug last longer than it ever had. When we pulled away, there were tears on the rims of his eyes. My last sight of my father was when I turned back before the road fell away again. He sat, alone, on a boulder near the road, the early morning sun making the land glow around him. I looked at the hills of my youth one more time. I felt nothing for them, but I knew I would miss my father. A caravan was crossing the Negev to Egypt only hours away from us, and I had to hurry to catch it. The day was terribly hot. They would be encamped at midday to wait for the heat to pass and do most of the travel by night. I would need to convince them to take me before evening, when they would set out again. I had enough to pay them for the trip if they were willing to negotiate. I even brought a few sticks of wood to carve toys for their children. This always worked at home whenever I needed to get out of trouble. I arrived in early afternoon. They were camped near a well that had been won by an alliance of clans in the last war, before I was born. It was now fiercely defended by a warlord named Bakba, who expected tribute when passers-by filled their pouches and watered their camels. Bakba. Yes, he will enter my story again. Many years later, when our people had finally left Egypt, Bakba was there waiting for us. But that is for another day. I saw several of Bakba's warriors, marked by their colors, reclining under the shade of a tent a short distance from the camp. The merchants must have been wealthy and paid quickly, since I had never seen Bakba's men relaxing like this. It was disheartening at first. A man stood a better chance of convincing caravans to take him if they were in need of money. I would probably have to use my carving. My time to barter would be short when it came. I did not want to disturb their rest now, but I also had to barter with them before their camp was packed that evening. I picked up a piece of wood and stared at it, waiting for inspiration. A bird cawed overhead. It would have been easy to fashion a bird, I had done many, but I needed to deeply impress them with this carving. Before leaving, I had sold my remaining carvings for the journey, even my lion, the best work I had ever done. It did not fetch as much as I was hoping, but I thought I had enough to travel until I found work. I pulled out a larger piece of wood. After an hour, I had fashioned a hawk's head cane, hoping there was an aging or lame merchant in the caravan. I gazed at it, pleased and hoping it would be enough. It turned out that it was more than enough. Mathia was his name, an old Assyrian who was impressed with my skill. "Your work is astounding," he said to me as he looked over my shoulder. I had positioned myself near the well where I could not be missed. "They would pay fortunes to employ you in Egypt." "That is my ambition," I answered. "I'll give you passage in exchange for your first month's take." I had no idea if that was a fair wage or not. "How would I pay for my lodging and food? I only have enough to pay the tribute to Bakba." "I know a man who will put you up. I will go to him when we arrive and make arrangements when we depart in a few nights." "A few nights? We are not leaving this very night?" Mathia smiled at me. "Bakba wishes to pay a visit to the larger caravans in person. His men inform us that it will be a few days before he arrives. It is not wise to refuse him." That night I lay down on my own at the perimeter. The other fires were spoken for, and there wasn't room enough for me to lie beside them to ward off the nighttime chill. I didn't relish the idea of being on my own when surrounded by strangers, but I managed to make a nice fire where I could put my feet near the flames. I scraped out a divot for my shoulder because I liked to sleep on my side. Then I draped my cloak over my legs and lay down. The cloak was a gift from my father. I would never have been able to afford it otherwise. Its wool was new and thick, its brown dye still fresh, and it would mark me for theft, so I knew I had to be careful. The flames warmed me, and I can still remember both the fear and satisfaction I felt before drifting off to sleep that night, my first on my own. I am a man now, I thought. I had bartered like a man, and now I would travel like a man. I stared at the endless stars overhead, the ones I had become so familiar with every night sleeping on our roof, wondering if I would still see them in Egypt. My eyes became heavy, but right before sleep they caught movement on the edge of the firelight. This was my first taste of battle. But it was also my first taste of treachery, for the well guards of Bakba I had paid off earlier that evening descended on me with terrifying speed, probably thinking I was wealthier than I had let on. I reacted just in time, their swords striking the sand where my chest had been. I managed to grab my bag as I rolled and threw it up at one of my attackers. I could not tell how many there were, only that they were attacking again, swords everywhere. My fingers found the dagger in my belt and I scrambled to my side. A foot clamped down on my back, pinning me. I winced, expecting the killing blow, but reacting in pure instinct, I plunged the dagger blindly behind me, hoping to hit flesh. I did, and the man screamed. I curled up, my feet under me, and leaped forward to gain distance. I landed and leaped again. My attackers were right behind me. After a third leap, feeling like a toad being chased by a jackal, I was able to turn around and face them at last. Four of them. I didn't have time to speak before one of them threw a javelin at me. I ducked and rolled to my side, the dagger out. Hit and move, my father had taught me, hit and move. I lashed out with the tip after sidestepping a club. The dagger penetrated the first man's face. Not pausing, not waiting to see what happened, I jabbed again and found a leg. As soon as I could jerk it free, I leaped out of the way, then sprinted as fast as my legs could take me into the darkness, away from the firelight. The howls of both wounded men echoed across the camp. I had been terrified, reacting like an animal, but now I was furious. The darkness was my ally. I could strike from the night and kill all of them. Battle lust came over me, the thirst for that as well. That unknowable power in a man's soul that bursts out of him and all he can think of is spilling more blood and avenging himself. It made me sharp. My ears were alert to every sound, every skittering of a viper across the sand, every dung beetle crawling near the camels. I smelled the livestock, the sweat of men, saw with perfect clarity the merchants and their bodyguards rushing up from the camp, one of the two remaining well guards leaning over his comrades. One of two? I heard the other one approaching from the side, but I was ready this time. He swiped a long blade toward me. I sprinted away, leaving the wounded guards and drawing him out into the desert. Even at this point, long before I would be trained by the Egyptians or alongside Joshua, son of Nun, I knew that if you were unsure of the strength of your opponent, you avoided him, making him chase you, avoiding all of his strikes until you could seize the advantage. I climbed a dune, my feet digging into the soft sand. The guard was behind me and gaining ground fast. When I reached the top, I turned, bent down for a handful of sand, and then leaped from above over his shoulder, watching his sword slice the night air toward me. I slapped him in the face with the sand just before he could finish the strike. He coughed and staggered. I landed, remembered my knife, and reacted again. I took two strides to reach him and shoved the dagger into his gut. I pulled it out and struck him on top of his shoulder. When he uncoiled and exposed his neck, I sliced it open. He slumped down. I was panting, desperate for air, exhilarated, all of those feelings you get after a fight. But my fury had not abated, and I charged down the dune and back toward the camp. I saw the group of about 20 merchants and their guards standing near the watchfire, listening as the uninjured Amalekite waved his arms about and told them some black lie. I slowed to a steady walk, approaching unnoticed from behind them. I proceeded past the merchants and directly to the unwounded well guard. A merchant spotted me and held up his hands. "We demand to know what has happened. He says you attacked his men." Before anyone could react, I raced forward and stabbed my blade into the eye of one of the wounded guards, then pulled it out and did the same to the other. I was so very fast in those days. Not like you see me now. By the time they could even raise their hands to stop me, I had kicked the remaining guard's torso, bending him over with agony, and then stabbed my blade into the back of his neck. He fell face down without another noise. I whirled on the group, dagger up. "These men attacked me while I slept, like cowards. Who wants to question it? Who?" I glared at them, too full of hate to take heed that I was outnumbered by armed bodyguards 10 to 1. There was a long silence. Then Mathia, the old merchant whom I'd bargained with, chuckled. "We don't question it. Those men charged us twice the rate they normally do to use this well. Although I fear you have created an eternal enemy of Bakba." My breathing slowed. He was right. It could never get out that I had done this thing to Bakba's men, or my town would be razed to the ground. Mathia shrugged. "I suppose we should be on our way early, then." I tried to pay him more to compensate him for his trouble, but he refused. We set out at a fast pace as soon as the camels were ready. He offloaded some of his wares to make room for me. I have dealt with many Assyrians, and they are mostly treacherous dogs, but I shall forever be grateful for Mathia. Egypt appeared after many days. I learned that the merchants were correct. It cannot be described. There is nothing similar you have seen in your lifetime. At my first sight of Ramses and Python, I would not be able to speak for many hours. The buildings of dynasty were everywhere. Their temples were lush with gardens and columns, street after street and block after block. Throngs of people, thousands upon thousands, teemed along the Nile in their daily affairs. Barges crowded the great river. The ships of Pharaoh's navy with their painted hulls and gleaming white sails rehearsed their battle drills. Fishermen picked their way into the marshes in narrow boats, watching one another like spies. When one boat would make a catch, the others would move in and make several while the finder struggled to empty his nets. Idols occupied every street. It disgusts me to think of it now. They worshipped false gods with the heads of animals and the bodies of men. An abomination. Abominations were everywhere. But oh, Othniel, how the world does not know the wonders of Egypt. If man worships himself as the Egyptians worship their god king, this is what he is capable of. Monuments to wickedness that dazzle the eyes. I could not comprehend the meaning of what I was seeing. Near Thebes were their great pyramids, burial tombs built by men that are mountains reaching almost to the stars. They were ancient even when our father Abraham was there. It became my prison, of course, though I would not know it for many years. Those same wonders were also the evil relics of a Yahweh-hating people. I shudder at the visions to this day and leave them to the realm of my nightmares. May the Lord be gracious enough to cleanse my thoughts of them forever when I am done with my tale. But I was astounded nonetheless. And when I finally arrived in the markets of Memphis and parted ways with my caravan, I realized how profoundly alone I was in this golden land.
Chapter 3, Keeping Watch. Caleb sat up, stretching his arms over his head. He gestured for the water pouch, and Othniel jumped up to grab it. Caleb took several long drinks. His throat was dry from so much talking.
"I will continue in a while," he said, wiping his mouth. "I have not had my morning meal."
"I will go get it for you," Othniel said. "But first, I did not know that you are not..." "Not what? Speak up."
"You say you were from Canaan."
"Yes."
"Which of the tribes?" "It is obvious, is it not? Just say it."
Othniel hesitated. "You are not a Hebrew."
"I was not born of the tribal bloodlines, but I am a Hebrew."
"But how is that possible?" Caleb smiled.
"How I became a Hebrew is part of my story. Do you wish to hear it or not?"
"Of course, Uncle. But you have not even mentioned my father yet."
"Your father will come into the story. Be patient."
Caleb waited for what he knew was the next question. The young man's eyes squinted, then cleared. "If you are not a Hebrew by birth, and my father was your brother..." Caleb interrupted him.
"A man's bloodline does not matter, only his heart. Yahweh gives his own bloodline to those who worship him."
Othniel nodded, but he was stunned. Caleb chuckled.
"Do not worry about solving it now. Just go find my food."
Othniel walked out of the tent. Caleb could hear him calling out to the cooks.
"Cooks," Caleb grunted to himself. "No cooks in the army in those days. A man made his own meal in the field."
He was thinking about complaining some more when he remembered he was talking only to himself. The rain fell steadily on, and he grew steadily colder. the other old generals, had young women lie in their blankets to warm them. Nothing offensive to Yahweh happened between them, but a woman in your bed was a woman in your bed. Always a good thing. He nodded to himself. That was surely one benefit of old age. He listened to the rain for a while, steady and heavy. Crops would come from it. Cisterns would fill. Ever since his days in the desert, he never took the rain for granted. He could not help himself and stood up, making his way to the flap. Stepping outside, Caleb rejoiced in the cold splatters on his face, the streams flowing into his beard. Cold, merciless, beautiful rain. He walked through the camp, keeping his cloak pulled low over his face to disguise himself from the men. He moved past cook fires, past mud-covered troops, past the food stores and to the perimeter. It loomed in the distance, hidden in the storm, but it was there. The walls of Hebron, the last holdout of the Anakim, the remnants of giants that had terrorized his people for a generation. "Your enemies reside there, God of Moses," Caleb said. "I will kill them tomorrow." As if in answer, lightning flared. Caleb saw the walls and the watchtower, the huddled figures of the sentries as they paced the wall. He smiled. "Their commander had them out on a morning like this? Good. That means they fear us." He glanced around and saw the boughs of a sycamore nearby. Sitting underneath it, he settled in and watched the gray light slowly enter the sky. Othniel would be looking for him. Some might worry that he was missing, but others would know where to find him, nearest the enemy. The sun was there, somewhere behind the clouds in the east. In this country, he rarely saw it anymore. Winter hid its light. But not in Egypt. There was no winter in Egypt, only eternal summer. He had not thought of Egypt in many years. Too much to concentrate on, too many challenges in building their home out of this land. The decades had buried it. But now he was there again, the cool ripples of the Nile at his feet as he stood on a muddy bank, the stiff reeds as they bent in the breeze, their tips scratching against the stone pillars of Pharaoh's palace. The street vendors with roasted cobra on spits and luscious fruits grown from seeds gathered at the ends of the earth. The smell of perfume on the women, lavender and rose. Caleb shuddered in the cold and wrapped his cloak tighter, stared at the gray sky and walls of the enemy, and thought of Egypt. It was not long before Othniel found him curled up under the tree. He knew to search for him on the perimeter whenever he was missing, and this was the place that most afforded views of their target. It was simply a matter of trying to spot the huddled figure under a drab cloak. A cloak much cheaper than the one that such a great man could have afforded if he wished. He saw the old man slouched forward with his chin on his chest, snoring so loudly that he could hear him even through the slashing rain and wind. He grinned to himself.
Chapter 4. From Statues to Swords. I made my way through the masses of people in the streets of Memphis, searching for the man I was told to find, Achan, the stone broker. Matthias the Assyrian said he was a powerful official in the court of Pharaoh, the god king. Through him came the hiring of all workers who wished to create the carvings and paintings that made the nation great, that captured their ancient history and promised to advance the kingdom into the next 1,000 years with edifices that could never be destroyed. But I had no way of speaking with the man even when I found him. The language was clattered and confusing to my ear. I could only hope to show him my work and let it speak for itself. After a day of searching in vain, getting hungry and weary from my journey, I decided to try again the next morning and found the sign for an inn. I paid the innkeeper enough copper rings for a month's stay and was shown my way to a room at the top of the building that overlooked the Nile and the plateau of the pyramids. As I ate my bread and oil dinner, I could not look away from the shining white mountains that towered over all. Their perfect symmetry, their golden caps. Thousands of workers moved up and down their steps, polishing and scraping away any imperfections on the limestone. Children slid down the smooth faces for play. It was apparent that they were the place of recreation for the entire city. The benevolent God King's tomb, where he could provide all for his people, even their enjoyment. They were pagans, yes, an abomination to Yahweh. But you must remember that I did not know Yahweh in those days. So as I tell this tale to you, do not recoil with scorn when I express the admirations and feelings I had as a foolish young man. I was consumed with thirst to know more about these people and their history of thousands of years. The first chance I got, I would go to the pyramids and climb their steps to watch the sunset. I would read every papyrus scroll in the libraries, not worried that I would make enough gold to pay the scroll keepers for access to the libraries, because how could a man not make his fortune here, the wealthiest kingdom on earth? As I was sitting on the roof of the inn with the other travelers in the cool of the evening, finishing my meal, a man approached me. He was an Egyptian, clothed in a white linen gown, and I noticed that his eyes were painted with what I had learned was the black liner of the upper class. He was in his fourth decade then, still young and passionate about conquering his private empire. "Are you the one named Caleb?" "Yes," I answered. "I am Achan the Stonebroker." I was shocked. This important official had walked on his own feet into a common inn and sought me out. And more, he spoke my tongue. "I am privileged, my lord, that you would come here, but I am afraid I am not worthy of it." "That is true," the man replied. "But I was nearby and was told by Matthew that you would be of interest to me." "My lord, 100 pardons, but how do you know my language?" "Men of Canaan have shown considerable skill here, especially Kenizzites. Matthew has never led me astray when I have searched for talent, and he has brought me many of my best workers. I learned your barbaric language in order to teach you the proper language, the Egyptian language." "Respectfully, my lord, I am not to be here as a slave." His temper flared at me. "You will be a slave if the God King wishes you to be so. You are here at his pleasure and mine. If you do not mind your words when speaking with me, I will have you sent to Python to cut brick with the Hebrews. Then we will see what happens with your skill." I said nothing, assuming he would calm down, which he did after a while. "What you say is correct. You are not a slave. Yet. If you want to earn your wages, though, you will do precisely what I require of you when it is required. If you produce, you will have more gold and women than you can imagine. If you fail, you'll be sent to Python. Be outside my house in the third quarter, the way of the falcon, by the end of the first watch tomorrow morning." Then he turned and left. I leaned over the roof and watched him depart into the crowded street to his waiting sledge. 4 slaves hoisted him up on their shoulders, and a crier shouted, "Make way for the stonebroker, servant of the God King!" People shuffled away quickly as he approached until he was out of my sight. As I grew to know him, I would discover that Achan was the smartest man in any room he walked into. Shrewd, calculating, arrogant, brilliant. I loved him in a way. Certainly respected him. I owe much to that pagan. May he burn forever in the fires of Sheol's depths. And so my first year passed. I carved and I drew for anyone who would pay me, in addition to whatever work I could get from Akan. I chiseled monuments to jackal gods, created maps for commanders, drew portraits for wealthy families. My name spread, and I was given gold. But one day I learned that my destiny was warfare and not the arts. Some moments occur, and a man knows that his life is forever changed, that no matter what he convinces himself about his destiny, it has been written for him, and he cannot escape it, any more than he can allow his heart to escape from his body. As I was walking through the streets of Memphis during a break at a site where I was carving stone animals to decorate a corridor of a wealthy man's home, I came upon an arena near a temple that I had never noticed before. It had short walls and seating for a crowd of only about 100, so one could easily see what was happening in the sand-covered pit. A man was standing in the pit, challenging any from the crowd who would come and fight him. He was enormous, heavily muscled, deadly looking. Several bodies were lying near him. He was at least 2 cubits taller than any man I had ever seen. I was confused, but many things had confused me since my arrival, so I simply waited to see what would happen. The crowd jeered and taunted someone, I could not tell who, until I saw a man stumble out of it and hold a sword up to the giant. I leaned in and asked someone nearby what was happening, but I could not make out the answer. The challenger approached the giant with the sword held warily. He had no confidence, no sense of bearing, no footwork, no training of any kind. The weapon may as well have been a cattle-prodding stick for all he knew what to do with it. The giant laughed at him. A woman was screaming above the clamor of the crowd. I tried to see who it was, but the people crammed in the streets had heard a challenger had come out and were closing in around me to see what happened. I was jostled around by food vendors, shoved by merchants, tripped over street children, but I finally caught a glimpse of the screaming woman. She was poor, her rags of clothing filthy. She was screaming in a tongue I had not heard before, and even though I learned the language well enough over time, I cannot recall what she said. But they were words of torment and anguish. She was reaching out for the man who was challenging the giant, begging and pleading with him. Her husband? With a mocking laugh, the giant brushed aside the man.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.